So I would now like to update you on our decision in the officer-involved shooting of Corey Jones. As you know, our office has been conducting an independent investigation of this matter since the October 18th date of the incident. We have gathered evidence and exchanged information with other agencies, including the FBI and the Palm Beach County Sheriff's Office. In Palm Beach County, the average time to complete an investigation of an officer-involved shooting is approximately 6 to 9 months. So despite the involvement of other local, state, and federal agencies, our investigation actually has proceeded more quickly than most. Our office interviewed 230 people in more than 30 states and 3 countries. The reason we interviewed so many people was the fact that the incident occurred next to an interstate with several hotels and businesses nearby. From the beginning, our desire has been to be as thorough and as transparent as possible. Although as prosecutors, we have unique ethical obligations that prevent us from speaking publicly about our investigation, we have remained in contact with the family of Corey Jones and their lawyers, and have met repeatedly with community leaders to provide whatever information we are allowed to give. I realize that this matter has generated heightened community interest, and we want to assure the people of Palm Beach County that our only motivation is to do justice. When an officer-involved shooting occurs, investigators from our office, along with an experienced assistant state attorney, head to the scene immediately upon being notified. I've gone to the scene of several of them myself. Our protocol is to conduct an interview with the officer right there at the scene shortly after the shooting occurs. If the officer cooperates and answers all questions, we then conduct an independent investigation of the shooting, and there is the potential for a closeout memorandum to be issued with no charges being filed. If unresolved issues exist and a closeout memorandum cannot be issued, then our protocol is to take the matter to a grand jury. In the officer-involved shooting death of Corey Jones, we have made the decision to present this matter before the grand jury during its current term. In the meantime, our investigation continues, and because this is still an open criminal investigation, I'm limited to what I'm permitted to say beyond my statement today. Normally, we don't even announce when we are sending matters to the grand jury, but in our effort to be as transparent as possible, we are letting the community know. In addition, our entire investigation will become public record and available to everyone once this matter is over. We have contacted representatives of the Corey Jones family to let them know of our decision and have already set up meetings with them to continue this discussion. As state attorney, I am in charge of running the grand jury. Chief Assistant Brian Fernandez is the lead advisor to the grand jury. The current term of the grand jury ends on June 30th. With that, I will entertain some questions, although, as I said, it's limited to what I'll be able to say. If you have process questions about the grand jury, I'll turn those over to Brian Fernandez. Yes, Katie.
After 6 months of investigating 4 separate agencies investigating this matter, why don't you have enough information to make a concrete decision on whether or not to prosecute the officer in this case?
Yeah. Well, every investigation stands on its own merits. It depends on the facts of every investigation. And we are following this office's protocol in officer-involved shootings by sending this to the grand jury.
Okay.
That's based on the evidence that we've obtained thus far.
Mr. Ehrenberg, can you say whether this will be a precedent for next or future officer involved shootings in the county?
If
Setting a precedent?
Well, every investigation is judged on its own merits. This isn't the first one we have sent to a grand jury. But every case, every matter should be reviewed on its own merits. And, you know, that's the decision we made here today is based on the evidence that we've obtained.
What would you say to those people who would say the state attorney's office is trying to pass this on to a different, you know, different entity so they don't have to make the decision that it's not a very transparent decision because it's a very secret process to begin with?
I've said repeatedly that our only goal is to do justice. And I think we've been as transparent as we're allowed to be under the rules. And I would ask people not to reach final judgments until after the process is completed.
Is there anything we can infer about this case, given that you are proceeding in this route versus proceeding with a closed-out memo?
Other than what I've said today, I can't add anything more to that.
How many sit on the grand jury, and when will it be presented to them?
There are a total of 21 members of the grand jury. You need 15 to have a quorum. You need to have 12 members of the grand jury to agree to, and I'll let Brian get into more process to pass something through a grand jury, essentially.
Yeah.
Well, this current term ends on June 30th.
How soon will they get
it? It'll be before then. It'll be this current term of the grand jury.
Weekly?
I'm sorry?
Maybe weekly?
No.
Now, if you're up for re-election, does this have anything to do with that? You know, you just don't want to get your hands dirty?
I think I can see you back. There you are. Hi. Our only goal is to do justice. This, I can tell you that politics has no part in this decision. If I really wanted to be political, I would have waited until well after qualifying, well after today to make an announcement. So this announcement is being made because evidence in to make our decision how to proceed.
So what charges are you able to explain? What charges would the grand jury consider?
I can't go into that. What I will do, though, I will turn it over to Brian Fernandez on some of these process questions and let him say what he's allowed to say. So I'll take a couple more and then I'll turn it over to Brian. Yes, sir.
Are you able to explain the nature of the FBI's involvement in the investigation? There's been a lot of questions, a lot of concern raised over the Sheriff's Office investigation, especially considering some previous cases that they've had. Can you lay out sort of who has been responsible for what as you've investigated this case and come to this decision?
You know, I can't go into that, but the FBI has been involved, as with the Palm Beach County Sheriff's Office, and we've talked with other agencies as well. But I'm going to also leave that to Brian to see what, because he's been more involved in the process, see what he's allowed to say. But I can tell you that I don't think we can say anything more than what I said today. Yeah, Terry.
Could you comment at all about the existence of an audio recording of that was playing while Mr. Jones was waiting for assistance and when the officer apparently approached them? Does that recording in fact exist, and does it have any role in your decision to turn this case and evidence over to the grand jury?
Yeah, Terry, I'm sorry, but I'm not allowed to comment on the existence or non-existence of evidence in this case. Yes, sir.
In Ferguson, the prosecutors there released the grand jury proceedings. Is that something you'd be doing if it does not result in an indictment?
Yeah. Well, after the matter is concluded, everything is subject to the Sunshine Law will be released to the public.
Including the grand jury proceedings?
Well, whatever is subject to the Sunshine Law. As far as anything else, that has not been discussed yet. That's something that would have to be decided at a later time.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yeah, you mentioned that ideally officers are interviewed immediately on scene or as soon as possible. Was Officer Raja interviewed on the morning of October 18th?
I'm going to questions about process of the investigation and the grand jury. I'm going to turn that over to Brian. Brian, being the chief of the felony unit, oversees the investigation of officer-involved shooting. So I'm going to turn that over to him because, as I said, we are really restricted to what we can say about what kind of evidence exists in this matter. Yes, yes, ma'am.
Is the Jones family already aware of the decision to
turn this over to the grand jury? Again, Brian spoke to representatives of the Jones family before we had the press conference, and so I'll let him explain what he can say about his conversation with the Jones family. Yes, Katie.
Did you guys consider an inquest
We did consider it. There are four options, and one is to close it out, one is to charge, one is to have an inquest, and one is to have a grand jury. An inquest is a rare option that has been used, but it's rare. But it's usually used to determine cause of death, and in this case, this matter, there is no dispute over the cause of death.
But you would have a judge involved in that, which, you know, would be a more independent sort of arbiter in this case. So why not take such a high-profile case to him?
Well, as I said, the inquest is really for to determine the cause of death, and since that is not at issue in this matter, we decided, based on the evidence that we were able to gather, that the best route is to go to the grand jury. Take one more, and then I'll turn over to Brian.
County, how many other have been turned over? How many other police-involved shootings have been turned over to?
Since I've been state attorney, which is now, what, 3.5 years, we've turned over two others. Yes. Yeah, I'm sorry, that would get into the evidence. I'm not allowed to respond to that, but perhaps some of these questions can involve process that Brian is allowed to answer, but as far as evidence and what kind of evidence, I can't answer that. We are limited as prosecutors ethically to what we can say.
Not so much evidence, but challenges between agencies where there are different findings that agents that you could not come up with a decision and want to pass on the grand jury.
Well, we have our own independent investigation, and I commend our investigators who I think have done an outstanding job. Also, we've had a really good working relationship with the other parties involved, the FBI and PBSO. There have not been any turf wars in all of our separate investigations and exchanges of evidence. So with that, I'll turn over to Brian.
Just on the table, here are your advisories for primer on the grand jury with exactly what the history and construction of the grand jury is, base comments, as well as a few other items we're going to get accordingly.
What did the Jones family have to say,
I spoke with the attorneys for the Jones family, and they were very appreciative of the fact that we had a conversation with them in our continuing dialogue. We've had multiple conversations along the way. We actually have a meeting scheduled for later today, and we will continue to have a dialogue with the families. And they were appreciative of being given notice of what our process would be.
Were they disappointed?
And being appreciative, what was their reaction?
You know, so far there was no negative reaction that I was aware of. Their reaction was one of understanding and patience. You know, obviously, if they wish to react in any way, it'd be best to speak to their representatives. But with both sides of the family, everything was very cordial and professional.
Have you spoken to Officer Raja's attorneys or to him about this?
I have had communication with Officer Raja's legal counsel, and he is aware of the process by which we're going to proceed.
Are you going to ask him to testify before the grand jury?
Obviously, one of the issues that we will not be able to talk about in regards to grand jury is any witnesses that may or may not be presented before the grand jury, and any evidence that may or may not be presented, and any timetable as far as the date or the location of the grand jury, or the individuals who are grand jurors themselves.
With the other two officer-involved shootings that were presented to the grand jury, what was the outcome of those?
Both were found to be a justifiable use of force.
Can you talk about the state attorney's office had its independent investigation, but there was also other agencies that conducted their own investigations. Was that part of your decision-making to take this to grand jury, or solely on what the state attorney's office found?
All of the agencies worked in a very well-coordinated fashion. There was no antagonism whatsoever. It was very collegial, professional. We relied on each other for some of the strengths that we have. And we ultimately make the decisions ourselves at the state attorney's office as far as the manner in which we proceed. Both the FBI and the Palm Beach Sheriff's Office made no recommendation to us as far as the manner in which we should proceed. They provided as much assistance as they could, and they did a very thorough job, and we incorporated all of their cooperation into the job that was independently investigated through our officers and ultimately reached the decision that we came to today.
Will you be seeking in terms of charges, or will it be open-ended? What can you tell us?
And as I had mentioned before, anything as far as a discussion as to what would be presented before a grand jury is not something that I'm able to get into. Yes, sir.
Brian, what's the time frame for when a grand jury reaches a decision or indictment to when the public is notified?
Yeah, and that's a tough question to answer because it really depends upon the issue that's presented before the grand jury. There are times where indictments are issued by a grand jury that are sealed for years and years because somebody may be a fugitive. In matters such as this, the full expectation would be that not only would the matter be presented before the grand jury, but then we would also have a response from the grand jury that would be issued prior to the termination of their term, which is June 30th. Yes, sir.
And was Rocha interviewed on scene, so how long after the shooting was he interviewed?
And I understand that you had asked Mr. Ehrenberg that question earlier, and there is actually no statement made as to any of the evidence that's been obtained in this case. And once again, I would not be able to even say whether or not he was interviewed, the level of cooperation or anything related to anything like that.
Any last questions?
There's an old saw that prosecutors could get a grand jury to indict a ham sandwich. Do you think that's a fair analogy, that if you push it, you could get an indictment?
I think that is something that's been created by people who have never been in front of a grand jury before.
Mm-hmm. Well, no offense.
It really is. For anybody who is actually presented in front of a grand jury, it is not that easy. You have an actual representative body of the entire community that sits in a capacity to question in a very open forum the issues that are presented before them. I have seen, and I've run statewide grand juries that lasted for a year and a half, and I've always seen them act in a very just way, in an honorable way, and in a way that they wish to do what is right.
Do you have a timeline for how long the grand jury presentment is going to take?
And that is, once again, something, anything regarding what would be presented, the constraints around that, evidence, witnesses, it's not something we can get into. Yes, ma'am.
Last question.
Yes, ma'am.
The grand jury, just in general, the defendant does not get to present witnesses, correct?
The control of which evidence and which witnesses are presented to the grand jury is twofold. It's by the advisors to the grand jury and also the grand jury themselves.